Welcome to Old World Order Theology with Brian Newberry. Today's topic is the continuation of the Dominici Pascendi Gregis by Pope St. Pius X, Part 2. It will be the Modernist as a Believer. If you did not see Part 1, the Modernist as Philosopher, you can go back and watch that one, because this will continue immediately from that section. So this is a rather long encyclical by St. Pius X. So I've divided it into the seven parts of what is a modernist and, you know, how is modernism manifested. So this one will be focused on the modernist believer. And in particular, this will focus on the topic of divine immanence, meaning that God reveals his truth and himself within the believer. You know, you might have heard evangelicals speak of having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, which is fine and well, especially if you are in union with Christ through the sacraments. But oftentimes, the emphasis of personal relationship with Jesus Christ gets put first and foremost before all else. So any kind of dogma or doctrine or systematic theology is seen as a hindrance to having the personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Because after all, it is God's revelation through the individual believer via the personal experience, which is the most important part, that is, for the modernist believer. Rather than God being transcendent and revealing himself from without in an objective way, the modernist believer holds first and foremost that God primarily and sometimes only reveals to himself from within. So any external objective dogma or doctrine has to be filtered through the personal relationship and through the inner experience or the subjective experience in order for it to be true, and it might not necessarily be true for all believers. And this is really one of the main problems with Protestantism, since it has naturally kind of dissolved into thousands of denominations based on what the individual's interpretation of the Bible is, and the individual interpretation is filtered through the person's experience. So, you know, for such a person, it would be anathema for someone to dictate to them what the Bible actually teaches or what, you know, the doctrines are objectively without the person's interior consent. So, I mean, I often pose it like this. If, let's say you have two professing Christians, Bible-believing Christians, and they both believe the Bible is the Word of God, inerrant and all that, but they come to an impasse that, what does this particular passage mean, right? And both will say, well, when I read the Bible, the Holy Spirit guides me. They both say that, but then they can't come to an agreement on what a passage in the Bible means. So, and both of their understandings contradict each other. So how is one to determine what does the passage mean? Which one is correct? They can't both be correct if they contradict each other. I mean, they could both be wrong, but at best case scenario, one is correct and one is wrong. They can't both be correct unless we believe that reality is full of legitimate contradictions, which would deny the formula of, or the law rather, of non-contradiction, that A cannot equal non-A. So how does one resolve, you know, such an issue where there's a disagreement that can't be resolved about what does a passage in the Bible mean, or what is theology, what is a particular teaching of theology, without an exterior, an external measure, which in Catholicism we call dogmas, you can't determine which is correct. And both of the believers also might have an experience, a religious experience, that contradicts each other also. So how do you determine which experiences from God and which experience is a product of a person's subjective feelings, emotions. Because, you know, people have very strong religious experiences through their own personal trauma, through their own, you know, kind of psychological disposition. You know, you might see, you know, certain outdoor evangelical events, maybe even at a baseball stadium, where you have some very good preacher preaching, you know, from the baseball field, right after a concert, where, you know, a bunch of people are getting very excited. They're worshiping to the music of the concert. They're up and clapping and waving their hands, so they're already emotionally riled up, right? And then the preacher gets in, preaches the gospel message, and says, if you come out here to the baseball field, you know, you could be saved, and we'll even give you a free Bible to go along with it. So that's a very strong experience for some people, especially if they went to attend right after some kind of traumatic event, such as a divorce, spousal abuse, something like that. You know, just recovered from a serious illness, or maybe they're going through some kind of cancer treatment. So they have a very strong religious experience. Does that necessarily mean it's from God, is the question. Well, for the modernist believer, it has to be from God, because a person cannot deny their experience, even if it contradicts a known Christian teaching that's been in effect for, you know, 1,000 years or more. So, you know, dogmas are not important to the modernist believer. So without further ado, and this is a short part of the encyclical, much shorter than the last one, and much shorter than the one to come after, The Modernist as Believer by Pope St. Pius X. Quote, now if, on advancing to the believer, one wishes to know how he is distinguished from the philosopher among the modernists, this must be observed that, although the philosopher admits the reality of the divine as the object of faith, yet this reality is not found by him anywhere except in the heart of the believer, since it is the object of sense and affirmation, and so does not exceed the confines of phenomena. So what does that mean? That for the modernist believer, the object of sense and affirmation doesn't concede the confines of phenomena, the phenomena meaning what is going on inside the heart and mind of the believer. Right? The phenomena meaning the goings-on. So the idea of, now, in this section, St. Pius X will often refer to science, and when he says science in this sense, he's not referring to the natural sciences where you study, you know, biology and all that. He's referring to the theological science, where objective truth is sought from divine revelation, the God out there, not the God in here. Continuing. Furthermore, whether that reality exists in itself outside that sense and affirmation, the philosopher passes over and neglects. On the other hand, for the modernist believer, it is established and certain that the reality of the divine definitely exists in itself, and certainly does not depend on the believer. But if you ask on what then the assertion of the believer, or the assertion of the believer, rests, they will reply, in the personal experience of every man. And this affirmation, while they break with the rationalists, to be sure, yet they fall in the opinion of Protestants and pseudo-mystics. For they explain the subject as follows, that in the religious sense, a kind of intuition of the heart is recognized, by which man directly attains the reality of God, and draws from it such conviction of the existence of God and the action of God both within and without man, that it surpasses by far all conviction that can be sought from science. They establish, then, a true experience, and one superior to any rational experience. If anyone, such as the rationalists, deny this, they say that this arises from the fact that he is unwilling to establish himself in the moral state which is required to produce the experience. Close quote. So here there's a contrast between the theologian and the modernist believer. So they're saying, if, let's say, the theologian is focused strictly on that which is revealed through dogma and theology, systematic theology, and they don't necessarily have the personal experience like the modernist believer does. So they don't have the mystical experience. They don't have the kind of inner feelings and, you know, personal relationship, you might even say, of the believer. Then they'll say, well, maybe that person just isn't, you know, morally good enough to put themselves in a position where they have the experience that the modernist believer has, you see. So then it becomes, you know, dogma and doctrine, that's not important. What's important is what I feel in here. That's what the modernist believer is saying. And that's what this encyclical is condemning. Continuing, quote, furthermore, this experience, when anyone has attained it, properly and truly makes a believer. Oh, how far we are here from Catholic teachings. We have already seen that such fabrications condemned by the Vatican I Council, when these errors have been admitted, together with others already mentioned, we shall express below how open the way is to atheism. It will be well to note at once that from this doctrine of experience joined with another of symbolism, any religion, not even accepting paganism, must be held as true. For why should not experiences of this kind not occur in any religion? In fact, more than one asserts that they have occurred. By what right will modernists deny the truth of an experience which an Islamite affirms and claim true experiences for Catholics alone? In fact, modernists do not deny this. On the contrary, some rather obscurely, others very openly, contend that all religions are true. But it is manifest that they cannot think otherwise. For on what basis, then, should falsity have been attributed to any religion according to their precepts? Surely it would be either because of the falsity of the religious sense, or because a false formula was set forth by the intellect. Close quote. I'm going to stop there for a minute. This really reminds me of Bishop Robert Barron's interview with Robert Shapiro, and I have a video on this. Is Jesus the privileged way, or is Jesus the only way? So in that interview, Ben Shapiro, a religious Jew, ask the Catholic Robert Barron point blank, as a Jew, you know, rejecting Jesus as Messiah, am I pretty much screwed, you know, eternally speaking? And Robert Barron kind of, he doesn't want to answer in the affirmative like a traditional Catholic would say. He kind of loopholes it that, oh, well, as long as you're a faithful and honest Jew doing the best you can to observe the Torah, and it's 613 commandments, then it's possible for you to be saved. You know, but he says, but Jesus is the privileged way, you see. So he would say that the Catholic religion is the best religion, but not all religions are false and lead to hell. So he's basically denying that, he's in a way denying the no salvation outside of the Catholic Church dogma, which has been asserted since the beginning of the Church established by Jesus Christ. So he's being a modernist. He's saying that it's possible that you might be saved in your religion, because after all, who can deny the religious experience of Ben Shapiro as a Jew? We can't do that, because for the modernist, it's the personal experience. Even though Bishop Barron would say that Jesus is the privileged way to heaven, and he would probably even say that Catholicism is the fullness, the most full expression of religious truth. He might say that, but he will definitely not condemn another religion, so be it that the person is honest in their personal experience with it. Yeah, pretty scary. And what else was I going to say? There'll be a lot of people who will say, you know, they'll give their testimony. You know, Christians will give their testimony. Oh, I used to be a drug addict. I used to be in a gang. I used to be a drunk. I used to be addicted to pornography, and et cetera, et cetera. But then I had my religious experience, and now I've conquered those vices and those addictions, and now I am sober. I am free, you know, for X amount of months, maybe even years. And they'll say that that's the evidence that Christianity is true. But you could say the very same thing for any religion. You could even say that for, you know, a troubled inner city black kid who was in a gang, is in trouble, and then he joined the Nation of Islam, you know, under Louis Farrakhan, and his life got reordered. He got out of the gang. He stopped selling drugs. He stopped going in and out of jail. And his life is now straightened out. He has a full-time job, a family. He has an ordered life, structured. So why can't the nation of Islam be equally true to the Christian who has their experience? In fact, they might even give Jesus a lot of respect. Of course, he can't be the Jesus of Christianity, because that's a different religion. But they could say, well, for this reason, the nation of Islam must be true because it helped this poor person who was on a road to a life in prison, and now he's an ordered, structured, fatherly, family man, right? And Saint Pius X explicitly uses the Islamist, right? So the Muslim, the person who converts to Islam could say the same thing. Why not, a Hindu, a Buddhist? Why not? Their lives got better after they had a religious experience. So who is to deny their experience as being valid and legitimate and from God, just expressed in a different way? So the argument goes from the modernist believer. But they would also be denying that God has revealed himself through truths which are absolute, dogmatic, which cannot be contradicted, because after all, if God is the truth, he can't contradict himself. That is, if you believe in the law of non-contradiction. But some might say, oh, that's such a Western white way of thinking. They'll say things like that. But you apply it to your real life, don't you? I mean, you can't say, I have $1,000 in my checking account, or maybe I don't, so I'm going to write this check. And whether I have it or not, that's not the point, because I experienced it. It's in my account. I know I have it there. Right, so the law of non-contradiction says there either has to be the money that you say that's in your account or it's not. It can't be both. And that same truth applies to the religious sense. And same thing in mathematics, same thing with anything. You get a pot of boiling water and you could hold it over someone's head and say, well, maybe it's boiling and maybe it's not. And you might experience it as boiling hot water when I pour it over your head, and it'll burn the skin off your foot, off your bones, and you'll scream in agony and so forth. But that's just your experience. You might not experience it. So that's basically what the modernist believer reduces religion to. You might, maybe if you don't have the correct experience, you're not moral enough. Very condescending. Continuing now, quote. Now, the religious sense is always one and the same, although sometimes it is more imperfect. But that the intellectual formula be true, it is enough that it respond to the religious sense and to the human believer. Whatever may be the character of the perspicacity of the latter, that's a word I'm not used to saying. In the conflict of different religions, the modernists might be able to contend for one thing at most, that the Catholic religion, inasmuch as it is the more vivid, has more truth. And likewise, that it is more worthy of the name of Christian, inasmuch as it corresponds more fully with the origins of Christianity. Close quote. So, like I said before, a person might say that Catholic faith is the most full and complete form of Christianity since the earliest Christians practiced Catholicism, as can be seen from in the reading of the early church fathers, but it doesn't necessarily mean that all forms of Christianity and the thousand denominations are wrong, you see, because who can deny the religious experience of the Protestant? Continuing, quote, there is nothing else besides in this part of their doctrine which is absolutely inimical to Catholic truth, for the precept regarding experience is applied also to tradition, which the church has hitherto asserted and utterly destroys it. For the modernists understand tradition as thus, that it is a kind of communication with others of an original experience through preaching by means of the intellectual formula. To this formula, therefore, besides, as they say, representative force, they ascribe a kind of suggestive power, not only to excite in him who believes the religious sense, which perchance is becoming sluggish, and to restore the experience once acquired, but also to give birth in them who do not yet believe to a religious sense for the first time and to produce the experience. Thus, moreover, religious experience is spread widely among the people, and not only among those who are now in existence, but also among posterity, both by books and by oral transmission from one to another. But this communication of experience sometimes takes root and flourishes, and sometimes it grows old suddenly and dies. Moreover, to flourish is, to the modernists, an argument for truth, for they hold truth and life to be the same. Therefore, we may infer again that all religions, as many as exist, are true, for otherwise they would not be alive. Close quote. So the modernists, they explain tradition as a means of keeping alive the personal faith, the interior religious life. So they say that through preaching, it produces the experience. So let's say someone's faith is kind of dying out, they're becoming skeptical, something in life has happened, and they just don't feel alive spiritually. They might go to Mass, they might go to their service, and nothing riles them up. But suddenly they hear a powerful sermon, and the preacher says something that triggers the individual to have the experience. And, ah, yes, now I feel God in my heart again. So my religion must be true because my experience is real. You know, it's suggestive power. So, you know, often the name and claim it gospel preachers of TBN, they're very big on this suggestive power. So they're very qualified and able preachers. They're very talented preaching. So they know how to use words, even the words of the scriptures, and they use them to trigger emotional and psychological and religious responses for the hearer, and they're very successful at it, and that's why people send them lots of money, you see, because that's a very powerful experience that a person has, and the person wants to keep that experience going. And so in order to keep it going, those preachers have to stay employed, and to stay employed they have to stay paid, you see. And that can go not just for the TV preacher, it can go for anyone. And so it keeps the faith going of people who already believe, and it could also produce the initial faith of somebody. Let's say someone's an atheist or an agnostic, or maybe even another religion. So they go to this this church gathering, they hear a powerful sermon, and they're convicted that this is the truth because of what's going on in their heart. Or like, kind of like with the Mormon religion, they say, if you have a, let's say a prayer, and if you have a burning of the bosom, right, this feeling in your chest, your heart's beating fast, you have a burning sensation, oh, that's because God is revealing to you what we're saying is true. So come on, join our cult, right? It's all the same program. It's modernism. It's religious immanence. Continuing. Quote, now with our discussion brought to this point, venerable brethren, we have enough and more to consider accurately what relationship the modernists established between faith and science. Furthermore, history, also, is classed by them under this name of science, and in the first place, indeed, it is to be held that the object matter of the one is entirely extraneous to the object matter of the other and separated from it. For faith looks only to that which science professes to be unknowable itself. Hence, to each is a different duty. Science is concerned with phenomenon where there is no place for faith. Faith, on the other hand, is concerned with the divine, of which science is totally ignorant. Thus, finally, it is settled that there can never be dissension between faith and science, for if each holds its own place, they will never be able to meet each other, and so contradict each other. Close quote. So now he's speaking of science not only in the theological sense, but also in the broad natural sciences of biology, zoology, and so forth. So in other words, traditional Catholicism always holds science and religion to be totally compatible and going in the same direction, God revealing himself supernaturally through the church and his natural law being revealed through nature and observation. Now, a modernist will have to kind of, in the same way they do separation of church and state, they do separation of religion and science, so that way they can never contradict each other. So the modernist believer can believe fully 100% in Darwin's theory of evolution, and also believe in the Christian faith, that the Bible is also true, and that the Bible teaches Darwinism only using religious language, but the two are together. So they never try to reconcile any tensions between science and the religious experience and their tradition. They try to separate them so that they never have to even really bring it up. And when you bring it up, they just don't want to discuss it. They want both to be true So, you know, they don't want to be rejected by the scientific establishment. They don't want to be rejected when they go to the university as seeing someone as a fundamentalist. They care about what people think of them, you see, and they don't want to have cognitive dissonance when there's tension. See, the honest theologian will always deal with tensions, and he'll even admit there are difficulties, but they work it out. The modernist doesn't want to because it'll interfere. If they get too intellectual and try to figure stuff out, it'll interfere with their religious experience. And they don't want that because the experience is what it's about. Continuing, quote, "If any persons by chance object to this on the ground that certain things occur in visible nature, which pertain also to the faith, as, for example, the human life of Christ, the modernists will deny it. For although these things are classified with phenomena, yet insofar as they are imbued with the life of faith, and in the manner already mentioned have been transfigured and disfigured by faith, they have been snatched away from the sensible world and transferred into material for the divine." That's exactly what I just said. Excuse me, rubbing my eye. Got sleep in my eye or something. All right, continuing. "Therefore, to him who asks further whether Christ performed true miracles and really divined the future, whether he truly rose from the dead and ascended into heaven, agnostic science will give a denial, faith an affirmation. Yet as a result of this, there will be no conflict between the two. For one, addressing philosophers as a philosopher, namely contemplating Christ only according to the historical reality, will deny the other, speaking as a believer with believers, viewing the life of Christ as it is lived again by the faith and in the faith will affirm." Close quote. So this is where the historical Jesus movement came in, where the historians took the Gospels and they parsed which parts are actual history that the real Jesus did and said, and which parts are the religious Jesus, the Jesus of faith, which is inside of the heart of the man. So they might, and strictly being scientists, they would deny that Jesus did real miracles. See, he didn't feed 5,000 people with 5 pieces of bread and 2 fish. That's physically impossible. What that passage is really speaking of is sharing, right? Jesus didn't really walk on water, he just walked on a frozen lake, you know, that kind of stuff. Jesus didn't really foretell the future, he was just very good at recognizing historical patterns and he projected it into the future. And he figured it was inevitable that the Temple of Jerusalem would be destroyed by the Romans. And so his prediction wasn't really all that shocking and supernatural after all. That kind of stuff. Continuing, quote, "A great mistake, however, is made as a result of this by anyone who thinks he can believe that faith and science are subject to each other in no way at all. For as regards science, he does not think rightly and truly, but it is otherwise with faith, which must be said to be subject to science, not only on one, but on 3 grounds. For first, we must observe that in any religious fact, after the divine reality has been taken away, and whatever experience he who believes has of it, all other things, especially religious formulae, do not pass beyond the confines of phenomenon, and so fall under science. By all means, let it be permitted that the believer, if he wills, to go out of the world, yet as long as he remains in it, whether he likes it or not, he will never escape the laws, the observations, the judgments of science and history. Furthermore, although it is said that God is the object of faith alone, this is to be granted with regard to the divine reality, but not with regard to the idea of God. For this is subject to science, which, while it philosophizes in the logical order, as they say, attains also what is absolute and ideal. Therefore, philosophy or science has the right to learn about the idea of God and to direct it in its evolution, and if anything extraneous enters it, to correct it." Close quote. So basically, the religion has to be subordinated under science and history, the natural sciences, because we can't touch the abstract. We can't touch things which are not material. So therefore, only things which can be measured materially can be absolutely true. So whatever you believe spiritually and religiously, that's your personal experience and your personal beliefs. But don't you dare bring that out to the public square and declare it to be objectively true for all people. Because if it can't be measured scientifically, it can't be true. That's actually very bigoted and a very narrow-minded way of thinking, if you think about it. Usually, it's the religious people who are called narrow-minded. and bigoted, but it's actually those who believe in scientism, and you could check out my video on scientism that I did and the errors of Darwinism. It's the scientism that reduces everything to science, and if it can't be measured scientifically, then it has to be subordinated. But that's modernism, that's heresy. That's exactly what he's going over here. Continuing, quote, "Hence the axiom of the modernist, religious evolution should be reconciled with the moral and the intellectual, that is, as one teaches whom they follow as master, it should be subject to them. Finally, it happens that God does not suffer duality within himself, and so the believer is urged on by the innermost force so to harmonize faith with science that it never disagrees with the general idea which science sets forth about the entire universe. Thus, then, it is affected that science is entirely freed from faith, that faith, on the other hand, however much it is proclaimed to be extraneous to science, is subject to it. All this, venerable brethren, is contrary to that to what Pius IX, our predecessor, handed down teaching, when he said, quote, it is the duty of philosophy in those matters which pertain to religion, not to dominate, but to serve, not to prescribe but what is to be believed, but to embrace what is to be believed with reasonable obedience, and not to examine the depths of the mysteries of God, but to rever them piously and humbly. Close quote from Pius IX. So Pius IX taught very much against modernism, and he said that science and philosophy must be subordinated under the religious truth and never the opposite. So the modernists will turn that around. That's why they really hate Pius IX. And they'll say, well, a person's religious experience cannot be denied subjectively, but objectively only science is true. After all, scientists are experts. And of course, scientists are always objective, and they're never, ever, ever motivated by salary, money, or position. Because after all, scientists can't be like that. Yeah, right. Continuing with Pope Pius X, quote, the modernists completely invert the matter. Okay, I already said. Oh, yes, they do. The modernists completely invert the matter, so what our predecessor, Pope Gregory IX, similarly wrote about certain theologians of his age can be applied to these when Gregory IX said these words, quote, some among you, distended like bladders by the spirit of vanity, strive by novelty to cross the boundaries fixed by the fathers, twisting the meaning of the sacred text to the philosophical teaching of the rationalists, to make a show of science, not for any benefit to their hearers. These men, led astray by various strange doctrines, reduce the head to the tail, and force the queen to serve the handmaid. Close quote from Pope Gregory IX. So, even in his day, that was in the 13th century, a long time before that, people were going after novelties, saying that, oh, well, there's some new science going on, some new phenomenal observations, so we have to put religious faith aside and go after that instead. Right, so they have everything inverted. The head of the church, the head of the universe, Jesus Christ, must be subject to what a mere human being can measure with his scientific equipment. Continuing, quote, this surely will be quite clear to the one who observes how the modernists act quite in conformity with what they teach, for much seems to have been written and spoken by them in contrary fashion, so that one might easily think them doubtful and uncertain. But this takes place deliberately and advisedly, namely in accord with the opinion which they hold on the mutual exclusion of faith and science. Thus in their books we find certain things which a Catholic entirely approves, yet on turning the page, certain things which one could think were dictated by a rationalist. So when writing history, they make no mention of the divinity of Christ, but when preaching in the churches, they profess it most strongly. Likewise, when discussing history, they have no place for the councils and the fathers, but when teaching catechism, they refer to the former and the latter with respect. Thus, too, they separate theological and pastoral exegesis from the scientific and the historical. Similarly, on the principle that science in no wise depends on faith, when they are treating of philosophy, history, and criticism, with no special horror about following in the tracks of Martin Luther. They display in every way a contempt for Catholic precepts, the Holy Fathers, the ecumenical synods, and the ecclesiastical magisterium. And if they are criticized for this, they complain that they are being deprived of their freedom, i.e. persecuted. Finally, professing that faith must be subject to science, they rebuke the Church generally and openly, because she refuses most resolutely to subject and accommodate her teachings to the opinions of philosophy. But they, repudiating the old theology for this purpose, endeavor to bring in the new, which follows the ravings of the philosophers. Closed quote. So that concludes this section of Pascendi Gregis. So they're saying that the modernist Catholic, you know, when dealing with history, they only deal with the historical Jesus. They do not speak of his divinity when they talk about history, because after all, history has to exclude everything supernatural and can only be taught naturally, so they think. And when dealing with science, they can't deal anything with the mysteries of God, the Trinity, any of the doctrines which are supernaturally revealed. They can only go with the idea of God as a cultural phenomenon and deal with it like that. They can't deal with anything dogmatic or doctrinally or, you know, something of what the Church Councils teaches as a theological truth. At best, historically, they might mention a council of what they taught, but they can only teach it as one religious phenomenon out of many. So that's what the modernist does. And they might even, you know, when they're in church, let's say the person is a permanent deacon, they might give an electric sermon or homily on a text, and they might preach Christ as Son of God. But when they put their science hat on, their history hat on, they can't speak thus because they might offend somebody who might be there and is not a believer. And the same thing when referring to councils, the Church Fathers, and the Pope, and the Magisterium, and the dogmas, they might profess them when they're teaching catechism, but in the public square, you know, they wouldn't dare assert that those things are absolutely true for all people, regardless that they believe them. Because modernists can't do that. They have to be subject to public opinion, and whatever is popular among people, especially if there are expert scientists and philosophers who don't agree. See, it really is about kind of self-esteem, the personal experience. So if everyone has a positive personal experience, and even if another person has one that totally contradicts one's own experience, how dare they tell another person that their experience is not from God if it doesn't align itself with what God has revealed is true. So the modernist believer acts as such. So hope this helps. Please subscribe if you haven't already. Like the video, share it with your friends. It helps a lot. God bless you. Nomine Patris, Filii, Spiritus Sancti. Amen.